Hi everyone, today we are going to discuss about two topics of biomedical instruments related to ophthalmology field. The first one is electroretinography, in short it is ERG. So the electroretinography is used to measure the electrical potential created by or produced by the retina when it is stimulated by light of adequate intensity. Regarding the electrical activity of retina, it is a composite of the activity given by photoreceptors, Müller cells and retinal pigment epithelium layers. A small part of the current escapes from the cornea, where it can be recorded as a voltage drop across the extracellular resistance, to be named as ERG. Regarding the history of electroretinogram, the concept of ERG came to the field of medicine, came to the medical industry by 1865 by the recording of an ERG by Swedish physiologist Ulrich Fritow. By 1877, Holmgren, James Dewar of Scotland, recorded the ERG of human beings. By continual improvement, in 1967, Ragnar Granit got the Nobel Prize for the field of physiology and medicine by demonstrating the concept of physiology of the receptor potential of each and every component of ERG. And then by 1989, International Society for Clinical Electrophysiology of Vision are started, by means that it is useful to analyze the ERG over all the world. By 1992, there is an improvement in ERG by means of it came with a new technique, and the advanced technique of multifocal ERG came to the clinical site on measurement of ERG. So, ERG requirement for recording of ERG, we are need of electrodes. So the regarding electrodes, we have three concepts are there. One is active electrode, the next one is reference electrode, and third one is ground electrode. The second requirement is Ganzfeld bowl stimulator, and the third one requirement is signal averager and amplifier, and the fourth requirement is display monitor, and otherwise it's a printer. Regarding the position of electrodes, so ground electrodes are to be placed over the forehead, whereas reference electrodes are kept at the outer canthus at the edges of the eyelids, and active electrodes are kept near the cornea. Regarding the technique of ERG, the active electrodes are to be named as the main electrodes. Regarding the electrodes having various types, the first one is hard contact lenses that cover sclerea, such as Brian Allen electrode, Durant gold contact lens, and jet electrodes is an disposable type electrodes are used. They are to be acted as an active electrode. Whereas for use of these type of active electrodes, we need of lens lubricant and corneal anesthesia. Sometimes filament type electrodes are placed on the lower lid, include gold foil electrode, DTL fiber electrode, and HK loop electrodes. So these are the types of active electrodes used for measurement of electrical activity of the retina, which is produced by photoreceptors, Müller cells, and EPG. The second type of electrodes are to be named as reference electrodes. It's made up of silver chloride, which is placed on patient's forehead, which is served as a negative pole as it is placed closer to the electrically negative posterior pole of the eye. The third one is ground electrode. It is placed on either on overlook, earlobe, or forehead of the patient. So you can see different types of electrodes used in ERG as we discussed earlier. The second requirement of ERG is Ganzfeld bowl stimulator. We said it is a stimuli. So the Gunspill bowl is a large white bowl which is used to stimulate the retina during the recording of EEG. So the Gunspill bowl stimulator diffuses the light and allows equal stimulation of all parts of the retina. Regarding the recording and amplification, there we are need of an electrical circuit. So the elicited response is then recorded from the anterior corneal surface by the contact lens electrode or any other type of electrodes. The signal is then channeled through a consecutive devices for pre-amplification, amplification, and finally it went for display. The protocol of EEG start with full pupillary dilation, and then you have to allow with 30 minutes of dark adaptation, so eyes are to be totally closed, and then we are just start analyzing the response of rods. We already known about rods and cones are available on the back side of the eyes, and then the second option is maximum combined response are came from both rod and cone response. By Cunneus it came with oscillatory potentials are analyzed. Further, we are starting with 10 minutes of light adaptation of eye, and then single flash cone response are analyzed, and finally the intensity is measured with respect to flickering of 30 hertz of light intensity. This is a regular recording protocol of EEG. Regarding the output of EEG, we have output of four types of waves are coming out. One is A wave, B wave, C wave, and D wave. So by the diagram you can see A wave is the initial negative wave. It is in the concept of it will be used in the area of dark adaptation condition, primarily from the photoreceptors. So in short, A wave has initial corneal negative deflection derived from the cones and rods of the outer photoreceptor layers. So it is a negative potential side. It is the initial condition of EEG. By continual, we are getting up action of retina leads with D wave. It's a large positive wave which arises from the response activity of the bipolar cells or from the Müller cells. Distributed by a ripple of 3 or 4 wavelets at the ascending limb, oscillatory potentials are achieved by using of that B wave. So the third type of wave output what we are getting is, the third part is C wave. It is a prolonged positive wave with lower amplitude, so considerably slower, and so it not to be used for clinical analysis, which represents the metabolic activity of retinal pigment epithelium layer. The fourth one is a D wave. It is because of off bipolar cells. Regarding dark adapted oscillatory potentials, responses primarily from the amacrine cells are inner retina. So latency of response refer to the onset of the stimulus to the beginning of the A wave. In this case, we have to know about what is implicit time or peak time, which is a measure of the time interval from the onset of the stimulus to the peak of the B wave. So it is nothing but how much of time taken between the starting of EEG response A wave to the maximum of B wave. Thus the normal response is actually a summation of individual rod and cone responses. So in order to derive clinical information from the EEG recording, it is essential to separate out the cone response from the rod response. So the overall EEG response by a retina is to be distinguished by 5 cases. The first one is rod response, and then rod and cone response are to be named as maximal combined response, and third one is oscillatory potential. So all these 3 responses are came from dark adaptation of our eyes, whereas single flash cone response and 30 hertz flicker response leads with light adaptation. So the diagrams below this response, you can notice the effect of rod specific and combined with rod and cone function and cone function alone, and then the fourth option is transient photopic cone function. So these are the responses what we got from the EEG regarding the work function of our retina. And then Regarding the type of electroretinogram, we have four options. The most common is fulfilled ERG, which is referred as standard or flash ERG. In this, retinal potential are measured by a brief flash of light, which is recommended for about 5 milliseconds of duration that eventually illuminates the entire retina. It's a very common method that we are using regarding ERG. The further improvement came with focal ERG, so where it is used to detect small focal lesions or pathologies which are missed by a standard fulfilled ERG. So a small stimulus of 4 degree of size is projected on the retina to be tested. So due to the light scattering and poor signal to noise ratio, this technique is mostly used in research setting than in clinical setting. By further improvement, we are gone with a multifocal ERG. So in this case, the stimuli consist densely arranged black and white hexagonal elements displayed on the CRT monitor. So these hexagonal elements change from light to dark independently and thus change results into recording of multifocal ERG. So we need of a stimuli that to be displayed on CRT screen if you are going with multifocal ERG. The next improvement on ERG, it is pattern ERG. So it is mainly represents inner retinal activity, so which is useful in differentiating optic nerve disorders from macular disorders. So unlike flash ERG, pattern ERG is a very small response, so which is recorded with full correction of refractive errors as visualization of stimulus from for extended time is essential for recording. So here we are working with a patternized display or to be screened, and then the retinal activities are measured. So these are the four types of ERG what is used on measurement of the retinal activity. So what are the use of ERG? So we already started with ERG is abnormal only if more than 30 to 40% of retina is affected by any of the diseases. So a clinical correlation is necessary. So medio opacities, non-dilating pupils and nystagmus can cause an abnormal ERG. And ERG reaches its adult value after the age of 2 years only. So less than the 2 years, we couldn't go for ERG measurement. So ERG size is slightly larger in women while comparing with men. So these are the interpretation of ERG. And what are the factors affecting ERG? By physiological, we say the size of pupil, the eyeball, age, sex, and then referential errors, diurnal variations, dark adoption, and anesthesia. These are the factors related to physiological. Regarding instrumentation side, we have a chance of amplification, gain, stimulus, and the electrodes plays a major role on creating the factors affecting ERG. And the artifacts are related with blinking, tearing, eye movements, air bubbles under electrodes. So these are the facts related to the factors affecting of ERG while we are taking the clinical measurements. Now we are going to the second topic, that is called as electrooculography. In short, we say it is EOG. By this measurement, we are going to investigate the integrity of the retinal pigment epithelium layer of the retina. So electrooculography is about EOG, is a technique of measuring the cornea retinal standing potential that exists between the front and back side of the human eye. So the resulting signal to be named as electrooculogram. By this case, the measurement of eye movements is done by placing pairs of electrodes on either above or below the eye or left to the right side of the eye. If you are going with ERG, we are just analyzing the electrical potentially created by retina by means of photoreceptors and Müller cells and RPE. Whereas here we are just analyzing the movement of retina on either sides by applying of stimulus. If the eye moves from center position toward one of the two electrodes, the electrode sees the positive side of the retina and then opposite side sees the negative sides of the retina. So the potential difference occurs between these two retinas are measured. In short, you say EOG is a measurement of electrical potential between the electrodes placed at points close to the eye, used to investigate eye movements, especially in psychological research. The eye has a standing electric potential between front and back, sometimes called as cornea fonda potential. So the EOG ranges from 0.05 to 3.5 millivolt in humans and is linearly proportional to eye displacement. So the human eye is an electrical dipole with a negative pole at the fundus and a positive pole at the cornea. Regarding the principle of EOG, so the eye, we already known that the eye act as a dipole in which the anterior pole is positive and the posterior pole is negative. The left gaze is nothing but the cornea approaches the electrode near the outer canthus of the left eye, resulting in a negative trending change in the recorder potential difference. Whereas you go for the right gaze, the cornea approaches the electrode near to the inner canthus of the left eye and resulting in a positive trending change in the recorded potential difference. So these eye movements leads with the difference of potential between the electrodes that is to be measured, to be named as electrooculography. So the electrooculography, the potential is mainly derived from the retinal pigment epithelium and it changes in response to retinal illumination. So the potential difference decreases from 8 to 10 minutes in darkness, and subsequent retinal illumination causes an initial fall in the standing potential followed by slow rise for 7 to 14 minutes of light response. So these phenomena arise from ion permeability changes across the basal RPE membrane. So you just notice the condition of EOG with respect to the movement of eye or eyeballs. You just find regarding light adapted the signal is differ, whereas on dark phase of 15 minutes the potential is differ. If you go with bright light phase, the amplitude of EOG is much higher. So by main study it shows a difference of potential with respect to the movement of eyeballs. So during the EOG, clinical electrooculogram makes an indirect measurement of the minimum amplitude of the standing potential in the dark, and then again it is peak after the light rise. So this is usually expressed as a ratio of light peak to dark trough and referred to as Andron ratio, Andron ratio. The ratio of the light peak to the dark trough is an accepted EOG measure known as Andron ratio. So the value of Andron ratio less than 1.65 is a subnormal response, and the values between 1.65 to 1.85 is a normal response, whereas the values more than 1.85 are supranormal. So with respect to this Andron ratio, the analysis of EOG are taken up regarding the normality or abnormality of the retinal movement. So regarding the advantages of EOG, the EOG is easy to use. The signals are measured with respect to the head. The head is about forehead. Registration of the eye movement with the closed eyelids and during sleep are also possible. Eye movement data are analog, and the sampling data of the following analog to digital converter can be chosen freely. The EOG is the most inexpensive eye movement recording system. These are the advantages. And regarding the drawbacks, the superposition of signals from mimic or chewing muscles is an issue, and dependency on changes in CRP, C-reactive protein, is also an issue. The third one is DC recordings always have the problem of drift superimposed on the signal of interest. So these are the drawbacks of EOG. And what are the most important application of EOG? So it is starts with an eye control based on electrooculography is designed to develop a system for assisted mobility. Assistive robotics can improve the quality of life for disabled people. Nowadays there are many help systems to control and guide the autonomous mobile robots. So in this case the system consists of a standard electric wheelchair or an onboard computer. Sensors and a graphical user interface are useful to work with the use of EOG for disabled people. So guidance of wheelchair is also possible. So a portable wireless eye movement controlled human controller interface is used for the disabled. So regarding the requirement, the first requirement is surface electrodes and two channel amplifiers, laptop and Zigbee. Wireless model is highly enough to prepare a guidance of wheelchair. And people to be suffering with the following disorders are to be easily analyzed by using of EOG: amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, brainstem stroke, and brain or spinal cord injuries. You just notice the use of EOG on guidance of a wheelchair and controlling of a robotic arm. The people with disabilities may utilize an EOG with respect to their eye movement. They can control the robotic system. I think you understand the topic well. We will meet you soon with next topic. Thank you.